Where there is no vision, the people will perish. Good morning, future farmers. I'm Aaron Alejandro of the Boys Ranch FFA chapter in the Area 1 Association with a vision for the Texas future farmers of America. It's hard to believe that a year has passed since I said those words on that stage in Houston, Texas, at the 58th annual convention. 60,000 miles, over 400 high schools, and just recently carried the Texas flag at National Flag Day ceremonies in Baltimore, Maryland. That vision, parts of that vision, well, they've been fulfilled, and other parts have been deepened and strengthened. When I ponder this vision, I think of the man who's a true patriot to our organization. He's a true patriot to America. As a matter of fact, today, July 18th, 1986, today marks the 194th anniversary of this man's death. This man is both noted for standing on the bow of his battered ship with his wounded crew members in the icy waters of the Atlantic during the Revolutionary War. He remembers standing there and looking across as he watched an arrogant British commander stand and say, "Do you surrender?" And John Paul Jones looked him in the eye and said, "I have not yet begun to fight." Future farmers, there's two parts to my vision. In my vision, unfortunately, I see a mere shadow of the organization as we once knew it. A remnant of what used to be 60,000 members strong, declining. It's a sad thought. But on the other hand, my young friends, I see a vision of exploding new programs, innovative ideas, and enthusiastic FFA members, making this the greatest organization in America. I see these FFA members, no, I see the Texas future farmers saying, "I have not yet begun to fight." Now, we've all seen a little caterpillar, and they crawl down the stem, they start munching on a leaf. And we've all seen a beautiful fluttering butterfly, but what about the time in that insect's life where he spins a silken cocoon? What happens during that period of that insect's life determines its destiny. What happens while he wears that cocoon determines what that insect will look like when that butterfly emerges after the metamorphosis. Well, like the caterpillar, my young friends, We are wearing a cocoon. It's a blue and gold cocoon. And when we shed this cocoon, hopefully, something that's been said or done while you wore this jacket, this cocoon, will make you a beautiful individual. Like the caterpillar, we will change. And complete metamorphosis will take over. Why? Because we have the opportunity to grab those opportunities and hang on to them just as tight as we can and make those visions, those dreams, a reality. This is where it begins. It's hard to believe I've been married to this organization for 6 years. September 3rd, 1980, my mother loved me dearly, as you heard last night, and she sent me 36 miles from here to a place called Cal Farley's Boys Ranch. I remember getting to Boys Ranch my first day. I walked in and everybody was staring at me. I was a mere 4'9", had hair down to my shoulders. I looked like an armpit with eyeballs walking around Boys Ranch. And I remember going and getting my hair cut from shoulder length to above the ears. I remember Mr. Chandler walking me into the high school, sitting me down with the counselor, and filling out my courses, math, science, history, English. And then I remember Mr. Chandler looking at me and saying, Aaron, you have to take a vocation. You don't have a choice. And I looked at him and I said, well, Mr. Chandler, I don't want to be no future farmer of America. I've seen all those cowboys in Texas down in Dallas, and I don't want to do that. And Mr. Chandler looked at me and said, Aaron, you will take vocational agriculture, the FFA. I never chose to be in this great organization. But as I travel across this great state of Texas, and I see you FFA members, and especially those of you who are dedicated enough to come to state convention, I look at you and I ask, why do you join our organization? You choose to, but seldom you choose to really succeed, to really dream dreams and make those dreams come true. I look now to my future with incredible excitement, with enthusiasm. Why? Because in 6 years, in this jacket, a metamorphosis, a total change has taken place. From the boy who vowed to his mother that he would drop out of high school after his freshman year, a boy who had already been to see the police for drugs, a boy who wasn't ever supposed to make it. With your help, my young friends, and with the help of Cal Farley Boys Ranch, stands before you today as your state president. And I thank you. I thank you. Total change. Total metamorphosis. It can be ours. Only if you succeed. Only if you're consistent. Only if you're persistent. And don't let anybody ever tell you, you can't. Because you can. In Collinsworth County, here in the Texas Panhandle, at Salt Fork, the Red River, not far from Wellington, Texas, there's a gravestone. On the gravestone, you see the word Sammy. Sammy was a young farmhand. Sammy attacked everything he did with incredible enthusiasm. And he did his very best every time he tried. Unfortunately, young Sammy died. Only at a very young age. But on his gravestone, it reads, Sammy done his damnedest. Angels can do no more. Future farmers, I hope that next year, when you see Aaron Alejandro, past state officer, alumni, young farmer, I hope you look at me and you say, there's Aaron Alejandro, the 1985-86 president. He done his damnedest. His damnedest is what he tried to do. And if you say that, then I've accomplished my goal. In 6 years of transition, I fully believe in what Mr. Zig Ziglar says in his book, See You at the Top. You are a direct product of the people you associate with. I thank my mom, my dorm parents, I know it was tough for my mom sometime this year when I'd come home discouraged about something I heard in Austin. And she'd always say, Aaron, it's going to be all right. We're going to make it through it. What about my friends in Dallas, Texas who are with us today? I remember coming home worn out from traveling, an average of 800 miles a week. Aaron, let's go see a movie. I'm tired. And he'd say, no, Aaron, let's go. He'd push me even harder. Huh. I've got to talk about my officers, too. They're a vital part. Greg Bates, I wish more FFA members would learn from your persistency. When Greg gets an idea, you better believe he won't stop till that idea comes true. David Knight, your quick wit is a fine example for every FFA member to follow. Area 4, Misty Hicks. Misty, the word sincerity in little sister, but most of all, team member, best describes you. And I thank you for a terrific year of service. Jay Hayes, it's incredible how come you smile every time there's an important job to do, and you always raise your hand and say, Aaron, I'll do it. Aaron, I'll try it. Brad Carlo, when I think of FFA member, I think of Brad Carlo from Mild, Texas. Brad stands proud and tall with his jaw firm and says, I am proud to be an FFA member. And my former Red Raider, Scott Samkin. Scott's a big old boy. They say that the most important thing you wear is not your clothes, but the expression on your face. Scott Samkin, you will never catch him without a smile. Area 8, your state first vice president. The closest that a girl has ever come to holding the title of state presidency, Nancy Tallett. Nancy, you don't know what an inspiration you've been to these FFA members, and they will never forget you. Area 9, Jerry Cole. Jerry, I admired you so much on our officer team, because every time we got together, buddy, you had words of motivation, encouragement, and you tried to pull us together, and that's what made this year a success. John Steelhammer, had I not ever been elected state president, I had the same goal that you had in mind, to be the state vice president of the year. God bless you, and I'm glad I didn't have to compete against you. These are 9 super officers. But that's not where it begins, future farmers. 10 state officers can't make a difference, but 55,000 members can. Because the 6 years that I was in this jacket, complete metamorphosis took over. The time has come, however, to bid you farewell. I must leave. But 36 miles from this spot is where it began for me. So I hope you learned something at the 58th Annual Convention. I hope you go home motivated and with a vision. And this is where it can begin for you. Now, like the butterfly, I must shed this cocoon. A direct product of what you have made me. I would like to thank you for taking an unsecure little boy and hopefully turning him into a successful young American. Again, this is where it begins for me and hopefully for you. God bless you.
Seasons change, days go by, people come and... Yesterday, I didn't have a clue. I stood alone, not knowing where to turn. Suddenly I look around, everything looks new. I don't know why, but I think I'm starting to learn. They call it understanding, a willingness to grow. I'm finally understanding, there's so much I could know.
It does seem like only yesterday that I didn't have a clue. I stood alone, not knowing where to turn. Now suddenly I look around, and everything looks new. I don't know why, but I think I'm starting to learn. They call it understanding, a willingness to grow. I'm finally understanding that there is so much that I could know. As I recite and listen to the words of the song Understanding by Bob Seger, all of the memories of the past 5 years so vividly began to race back through my mind as if it were yesterday. I remember back to my first state convention. I was a green hand then, sitting on the delegate floor in awe and in amazement at the things and the events that were taking place around me. It was then, though, that I decided exactly what I wanted to do. I decided that I would do whatever it took to one day be up on that stage. For 3 years afterwards, I worked. And as a result, last year in Houston, Texas, I had that opportunity to be on a stage. For you see, I gave my bid for state president. Obviously, I fell a little short of that goal. But you know as well as I do that one goal leads to another. My next goal was to be the best state vice president that I could possibly be. And I'd like to think that somewhere I've left an influence that can make that so. However, as I look back at that day in Houston to the speech I gave, I talked of several things, and I remember some of the things and the messages that I had to pass on to you. I talked of sacrifice, of risk, and of friendship. We all, at one time or another, sacrifice some of the things necessary in order to achieve the things that we want. And in the same manner, we risk some of the things that we already have because we dare to stand up and fight and speak out for the things that we believe in and for the things that we have faith in. As I speak of belief and faith, I think of a man who lived a long time ago who demonstrated total commitment, total faith, and total belief. He was a rich man, not only rich materially, but rich in his beliefs. One day, Satan came before the Lord and said, "I can make this perfect man of yours turn against you. I can make his faith falter." By the time Satan was finished with the man, all of his worldly possessions had been stripped of him. His livestock was slaughtered, his family was killed, and he was diseased. Yet, through all of his suffering, he didn't give up. His friends and his wife told him, they said, "Curse God and die and end your suffering." But through his strong faith, he didn't falter. For you see, this man was tested, probably to the most extreme circumstances. But through his extreme faith, he didn't give up. He didn't give up. For you see, for his commitment to God, he regained everything he had once before twice over. His livestock was returned. His family was returned. His health was restored. For you see, this man gained a precious understanding of his faith. This man's name, however, was Job, from the book of Job in the Old Testament. Future farmers, the same holds true for us. No matter how negative the things are around us, no matter how bad it really is, if we stick to what we believe in, if we have faith in ourselves and our organization, then we will reap the benefits in the end. For you see, every one of us at one time will reap the benefits. Over the past year as a state officer, I've gained an understanding of what this organization is and what it's really all about. I've watched you, the members of the Texas FFA, show that same type of belief and the faith in yourself and in our organization the way Job did. My friends, at one time or another, we're all going to be tested in that same way, whether it be in the FFA or whether it be in whatever we do in life, we're going to be tested. And whatever the case may be, we've got to prepare ourselves now. We've got to prepare ourselves now for those tests and for those challenges and for those obstacles that are surely going to pass away. And already, over the past year, there's been a whole lot of obstacles that have popped up. But on the other hand, I've seen as many FFA members arise to the occasion to overcome those obstacles, because there's nothing more rewarding to me than to see your faces light up with enthusiasm and excitement at the thought of knowing that you accomplished something. For at that time, you gain an understanding of yourself. You gain an understanding of all the time and the dedication and the effort that you put forth. You understand that now it was worth your time and it was well worthwhile. When I ask myself, however, was it all worthwhile, the things I did this year? That answer is pretty simple. It's a clear-cut yes. Whenever I visited one of your chapters, whenever I was involved in different FFA activities, and whenever I was in contact with you, the 55,000 members of the Texas FFA, the answer still remained yes. Every time I pulled in to one of your towns and I see one of your FFA welcome signs on the side of the highway, and every time I pull into one of your schools and see the American flag of ours waving in the breeze, it would make me think of how fortunate and how lucky we all are to live in such a country. It also would make me think of how fortunate we are to have the people in the background that we did. For you see, it made me wonder about our founding fathers. When they were constructing this great nation of ours, I wonder if they had the understanding of what they were doing and what lay ahead. I also wonder if they had us in mind when they put the blue on that flag. I thank the Lord for people like that who gave us the opportunity to live the way we do today. I thank the Lord for a lot of other people that have made this year possible for me. Of course, to my parents, Mike and Kay, and my sister, Stephanie, who gave me all of the love and support that I needed throughout the year. And to my ag teacher, Mr. Bryson, who, when I felt like throwing my arms up in disgust and quitting, he kept me going and he kept me interested. And to the people back in my home chapter of Clint, who really gave me the support I needed and who are really responsible for me getting where I am today. And a big thanks to you, the 55,000 members of the Texas FFA, for making my year of service what it was and worthwhile. As I contemplated on what I was going to say in this speech, I dreaded what I had to do now. I have to address probably the most important part of my year, and that's the nine standing back there. Through all the good times, through all the bad, through all the arguments we've been through all the fun times, myself and those nine other state officers, we stuck together. We stuck together as a team, and we stuck together as a family. And you guys, you gave me the understanding of the true meaning of the words love, caring, and friendship. And I'll be forever in your debt for that. And I love you all for that. Future farmers, as I take off my jacket for the last time, and as those other nine take off their jacket for the last time, and we pass the reins of leadership over to your new 10 state officers, we leave them and we leave you still yet another long, hard road to travel. But be assured, from what I've observed this year, you're the ones that are going to make that road a little bit easier to travel and a little less trouble-free. For you see, all you have to do is to keep dreaming those dreams, keep setting those goals, and keep going for it. And above all, gain an understanding for yourself and what you stand for. God bless you all.
I used to just get lost. I only heard the things I wanted to hear.
One of my first memories of the FFA was attending a state convention in Dallas, Texas. I wasn't really too sure what the program was all about, but one thing that stands vividly in my mind is something I can't forget, was watching those 10 state officers walk up here in front of all you, these people, and just spill their heart about what they felt. Now, I didn't even know what a state officer was, but I was wondering what was it that made them want to get out there and do something like that, and to be a state officer. Well, after this year, now I know. When I thought about what I was going to use for my retiring address, I thought I was going to use a real sad song and come out here and just tell you how sad I was to be leaving the FFA. But then thinking it over, I said, why be sad? This has been the greatest year I've ever experienced in my life. There's nothing sad to look back on. Listening to, over the past five state conventions I've been to and listening to the state officers, they'll always tell little experiences they've shared throughout the year. There's two that stand out in my memory I'd like to share with you. At the Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo, I was working the children's barnyard. If you've ever been in the barnyard, you know what an emotional experience it is. As you see these children, some that can't see or have other physical handicaps, or someone from the inner city come up and look at the animals, and the look on their faces, it leaves you with a feeling. This year, these children that come to the barnyard, they left me with the chicken pox. Something I had never had before, and I'll always remember them. Another experience happened more recently. Yesterday morning on this very stage, as the state officers came out, we presented our advisors. I walked up, I introduced them, I presented them with a token of appreciation, which no way thanks them enough. We had a photograph and I walked back in line. And as I stood over there and I looked up and down everybody's advisors and Misty was walking up with hers, that was when I realized that the zipper on my pants had broken wide open. And there was not a thing I could do about it. Luckily, one ag teacher didn't make it, and his certificate was readily available for cover. Things like that can only happen at the wrong times. But they leave you with a feeling that, hey, you know, it's okay. Everything's going to work out all right. We've had a lot of tough times this year in the FFA. You might say the storms of life have unleashed their fury on us. But let me leave you with a little story. I've had the honor of living next to my grandparents, growing up with them all my life. They have the most beautiful garden in their yard. There are plants, there's flowers all over, always in bloom, it's gorgeous. Well, recently, Mother Nature decided Houston needed about 1.5 inches of rain, 4 times a day for a week. And it rained, and it rained, and it thundered, and the lightning, and we lost power and everything. And I began to think, oh, I bet my grandmother's flowers are just drowned out over there. There's no way they can make it through that. Well, the sun came out one day, and I was just walking around with the dogs, and I went into their backyard, and I walked over there, and those flowers were reaching for the sky. Nothing was going to stop them. They were standing tall and didn't give up. And I was thought to myself, you know, after all that has been unleashed on them, after the wind and rain have lashed them for a whole week, the flowers were still standing. The flowers were still standing, future farmers. And no matter what the weather brings our way, if you stand tall and reach for the sky, nothing's going to get in your way. One of the hardest things to do is to stand up here and say goodbye. We as state officers will be involved in the alumni, of course, and everything, but this is the last time to wear the blue and gold jacket. And I think back on what got me involved in this and everything, and I need to thank a few people. My advisors, Mr. Craig Harden, for giving me the opportunity and something to believe in. Dr. Larry Bennett, you gave so much to so many, got very little in return, and then you gave more. Mr. Philip Dorman and Guy James, I want to thank you for putting up with all my crazy ideas, my problems, and my dreams. You went beyond the call of duty, and then you asked what else you could do. I love y'all very much. Mom and Dad, this year, you are my last-minute saviors. I need a booth for the area convention tomorrow. What am I to do? I got to have a speech written. My scrapbook's not done. Mom, I ran out of underwear. Y'all questioned me and said, David, look, you need to get these things in order before you go. But, of course, I never did. But then you were there. To the Kingwood FFA chapter. Members in there for giving me a start and something to believe in. You keep going and nothing's gonna stop you. And last but not least, my new family, the nine brothers and sisters. Y'all stop that, you're gonna make me cry. We've grown up together. We've gone through a lot. Many miles, a lot of bumpy airplane rides. When I got all these ideas, y'all listened to them. It was too late to do anything with them, but you were there. I love you very much. They say home is where the heart is. Well, there's nine places across the state of Texas where I'll be then. Think about what we did and why we did it. We did it all for love. I love you very much. Future farmers, thank you. Keep reaching for the sky.
Future farmers, the time has passed by rapidly this year being a state officer. As I sat down to prepare this speech, I began to realize how fortunate I was to be a part of this great organization. This year will remain a part of my life that I will cherish. I will never lose the friends I have made or forget the many exciting ag trips that I have taken. I can truly say I will always remember these most exciting, rewarding moments and five wonderful years of my life. How many of you ever cherish your gift of life? Or do many of you ever get caught looking back on things when the time clock is run out? Let's start from the beginning of your gift of life. On the day you were born, you were a beautiful, unopened gift of life, just like a great big package in shiny paper with a huge satin bow. You are still this wonderful gift. No one opens your gift of life but you. You alone open your gift, and you alone take out your talents, traits, and abilities. Others cannot open your gift, nor can they take anything out of it, even when they know it's there. Parents can't open your gift, nor your friends, no matter how much they want to help you or encourage you. You alone can reach in and take out what is within you. For each and every one of us, life is a do-it-yourself project. How far are you into opening your gift of life? I have a personal story that happened to a friend of mine. The guy was 19 at the time of his accident, and it's now been 3 years. Monty was a good-looking, fun-going guy going to school on a baseball scholarship when one night of so-called fun nearly ended his gift of life. The accident happened in January of 1983 when Monty decided to go out and get drunk. He decided to leave town late that night, and as he was driving out of town, he swerved into the ditch and his pickup got stuck. He decided that he would get out and hitchhike a ride, but as he proceeded out on the pitch black highway, a car came and struck him with such force that it knocked him out of his shoes. For weeks and weeks, there wasn't much outlook for Monty's future. But as the weeks and the months drew on, things have become better. At the present time, Monty is in a rehab center in Tennessee. His speech is very slurred and is now having to relearn to use his legs to walk again. His vision is slightly damaged, along with the use of his arms. The reason I am telling you this story is Monty's life was taken for granted. Not by you and me, but by Monty himself. One other story is one that hit me personally. This FFA jacket is 27 years old. It is the one that my daddy, Ray Hicks, wore as a green hand in Van Alls, Oklahoma. I can truly say I have worked hours and hours with him, farming side by side, and constantly learning something every time. He taught me mainly all I know today, but what I regret now is that I never took the time to tell him thank you for the advice and for always giving me his many hours of support and help with my projects. He was always there whenever I needed a friend. Daddy was there for anyone who ever needed an extra hand or a bit of advice. For you see, I took him for granted for always telling me new ideas to try, and I thought that he'd always be around. But you see, future farmers, I don't have him around now to share his wisdom with me or have him near to protect me. This realization is one for all of us to consider. We don't live forever. The present time is our most precious. Let's pretend for a moment there is a football clock with your name on it, counting off the minutes of your life. Tick, tick. When it stops, nobody knows. What we do know is that there are no timeouts, no substitutions, and no instant replays in this game of life. This game is the big one. It is our own personal Super Bowl of life. Think about your gift of life. What do you want out of yourself? Reach into your gift and take out something new. Your gifts, talents, and abilities are within you, waiting for you to discover them. Future farmers, I have reached far into my gift of life for the past 5 years, and I hope that I have given to each of you my talents and my abilities. We must look to this day, for it is life. For yesterday is but a dream, and tomorrow is only a vision. But today well lived makes every yesterday a dream of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. Look well to this day.
Thank you. You know, future farmers, I really love this song. I don't see how anyone cannot listen to it and feel the blood pumping through your body, the hair stand up on the back of your neck, and feel your toes tapping. You see, there is a stir across the land, across this great state. My year as a state officer, I have seen young people concerned about their future, concerned about the things that are happening to them. And I'm very grateful for the opportunity to have been able to view all of these things. I must say that having this opportunity has been so special to me that I've looked at every corner, at every turn, for the opportunity to give something back to this great organization. If there's one thing that I might say, I remember back when I came to my first convention in Dallas, Texas. At that convention, just like you, the only thing I had on my mind was I wanted to have a good time at that convention. And I did. But you see, I made one mistake while I was in Dallas. I stopped, and I looked, and I listened to all the things going on. And because of that one mistake, it is probably why I'm here today. As I watched the people involved in our organization, the state officers who inspired me, the people who worked at the area desks, I was so inspired by their motivation, their outlook on life. I said, hey, I want to be part of that. I want to make a positive contribution. And yet, whenever I see young people around today that are burnt out on life, that are into drugs, that are dropping out of school, that are no longer a part of the human race, I have to sit and wonder why. I realize that fun in our organization seems to be a little bit harder to come by these days, but it's still there. But I guess there's one thing that I just can't understand. It's why when we have politicians and business leaders who continually rampage about the problems with the young people in our state, the problems with crime, the problems with dropouts in high school, I cannot understand why these same people will go out of their way to attack an organization that is doing its very best to keep kids in high school, to keep kids a part of life. You know, I'm just a good old boy from Wolf City by way of Yanis, Texas, and I just can't figure this out. I wish someone would explain this to me. Why these very same people can't see that we're not the answer, but at least we're trying. We're trying to do something good here. And as I've gone through my year and watched people doing their very best, that has also inspired me to attempt to do my best. I guess if I had to point out the things that I saw, I could sum it up in these words. That kid on the roof is not afraid, not at all, nor is he afraid on a high towering wall. It's risky, it's crazy. Yes, that is the truth. But how much we owe to this rashness of youth. Youth's raw and it's on it. It still acts like it feels. Still dares to climb trees and hang by its heels. That kid on the roof is but youth on the bound. He grabs for the stars while I stand on the ground. Whenever I hear adults who say, gee, I wish I were 16 again, Texas wouldn't be big enough, I think of that saying. Right now you have that opportunity. You are 16, 17. And the way I figured it, if you start right now, you have 162,000 seconds left in the 58th annual Texas FFA convention. And if you'll remember the feelings that you've experienced so far, I know you won't remember everything that everyone said. I've listened to 51 retiring addresses, and if you gave me a quiz on all of them, I don't think I'd do very good. but I remember how they inspired me. I remember the things that they taught me. I remember the feelings at that time. If you'll use your time here at the convention wisely, go ahead, meet some people. Elevators are a great place to meet people. Use that. You've had your eye on that guy or that girl. You know, go ahead and say hi. Where are you from? Glad to meet you. And you'll have made a new friend. If you don't do anything more than that at this convention, then myself and my 9 very special brothers and sisters will have done our job. Because when you leave Amarillo, you'll think back and say, hey, I was a part of something very special. But most of all, if there is anything that I could give you, some advice that I might give you, and at the same time sum up my year as a state officer, I would leave you with this. Do not worry that your task is small and that your rewards are few. Remember that the mighty oak was once a nut like you. Thank you, future farmers, for a most inspiring year.
Over the past 12 months, we as your state officer team have strived to provide the leadership and motivation to ignite a spark inside each and every one of you that you and only you can mold into that burning desire to be the best that you can be. I'm sure that most of you have heard the song, Pass It On, which begins, "It only takes a spark to get a fire going." There needs to be a fire in all of our members in the Texas Association of Future Farmers of America. For you see, we have something to be proud of, and we must stand up for what has placed us where we are today. As the theme from Rocky IV goes, reverently we hope against all hope. There is so much at stake, seems like freedom's up against the ropes. Our organization seems as if it is up against the ropes, and so does the agricultural industry. We've been through several tough rounds, and we may be bruised and battered, but we are not going to be defeated. Agriculture has been through tough times before, but has always managed to come back strong. We will again. Just as Rocky faced extreme adversity of his friend Apollo's death, and having to fight his battle in a foreign land, we too must face adversity and meet eye to eye with our problems. You can make the difference in our organization's success. It is up to you. You may be asking yourself, what can I do? I don't have anything special to give that will make a difference. But I disagree, because everyone has something special, some special talent in which to give that will make a difference. Last year in Houston, I told you something that still has great meaning, and we must say to ourselves, I am only one, but I am one. I cannot do everything, but I can do something. And what I should do and could do, by the grace of God, I will do. Success comes not from being the best. Success comes simply from giving your best. You have to do more than want it. You've got to go get it. We have to have confidence in ourselves, our organization, and our industry. Success is not magical. It comes from dreaming, refining our dreams into ideas and our ideas into actions. The first step will always be pursuing our dreams with enthusiasm. And soon, we begin to understand that the greatest inventors, the best scientists, and the most successful leaders started with ideas. They didn't listen to those fears that told them that their ideas wouldn't work. Instead, they took a chance. They took a chance on themselves. Future farmers, take a chance on yourself. Is there a dream you have never pursued? Is there a desire that has never been fulfilled? What are you waiting for? What holds you back? Some men stay right in the rut, while others head the throng. All men may be born equal, but they don't stay that way long. One person, however, is not going to be able to gain the total success that we want for our organization. We're going to have to work together to achieve the things that are within our reach. I like to put it like this. We serve better together. The continued success of the FFA is going to take a team effort with each and every team member doing his or her full part. Sure, we're going to have setbacks, but we cannot give up just because we may encounter obstacles on our road to the top. In the warrior's coat, there's no surrender. Though his body says stop, his spirit cries never. Deep in our soul, a quiet ember knows it's you against you. It's the paradox that drives us all. It's a battle of wills. In the heat of attack, it's the passion that kills. The victory is yours. Yes, the victory is yours, but it is also ours. Ours together. We have to fight a constant battle with ourselves to stay motivated enough to achieve the goals that we have set for ourselves, our organization, and our industry. We cannot become complacent or content. We cannot just tread the water of time. We are either going to move forward or we're going to be carried backward by the current. As I said, we cannot give up. I remember a poem that sums up this idea. The man who quits has a brain in hand, as good as the next, but he lacks the sand that will make him stick with the courage stout to whatever he tackles and fight it out. He starts with a rush and a solemn vow that soon he'll be showing the others how. Then something catches his roving eye, and his task is left for the by and by. It's up to each man what becomes of him. He must find in himself the grit and vim that brings success. He can get the skill if he brings to the task a steadfast will. No man is beaten till he gives in. Hard luck can't stand for a cheerful grin. The man who fails needs a better excuse than a quitter's whining. What's the use? For the man who quits lets his chances slip just because he's too lazy to keep his grip. I'm sure that right now at this convention, you're ready to go back home and to be the best that you can be and to motivate your chapter to be the best. And after you get home, you say to yourself, man, I sure am tired. It's good to be home. And soon, you forget. And this fall, when you get back to school, the motivation is not quite what it was. That is where the burning heart comes into play. I want to challenge you to take the little spark, that quiet ember that you obtained from the Future Farmers of America, and transform it into a light and warmth-giving fire that will benefit you as well as those around you. We have tried this past year to provide that spark, just as it was provided for us many years ago.
and before the gavel taps to end this convention, and my years of service to this great organization come to a close. There are several people that I must thank. First and foremost, I must thank the Lord Jesus Christ for giving me this opportunity and for protecting me through my year of travel. Next, I must thank my mom, my dad, my little brother, Annette, and all the rest of my family that have loved me and encouraged me, stood by my side and helped me do everything through all my years of active service. I love you. So my advisor, my friends from back home that have encouraged me, stood by my side in good times and bad, and traveled along with me, I say thanks. You're the best friends a guy could have. To 9 of the best state FFA officers to ever come out of this organization, I want to say thank you for the love and support that you've given me this past year. And even if our paths never cross again, which I hope is not the case, I love you and I'll never forget you. But maybe one of the most important things goes to you, the Texas Association of Future Farmers of America, for giving me this opportunity to serve you in this capacity and for the friendships that have developed because of it. The times that we have cherished, the times that we have shared will always be cherished in my memory. I would like to leave you with this thought. If you don't put anything into life, you won't get anything out. Keep that burning desire and keep striving to be the best that you can be. And with that, I wish you luck and I bid you farewell.
Stood there boldly, sweating in the sun. Felt like a million, felt like number one. The height of summer, I never felt that strong, like a rock.
Future farmers, as my career in the FFA is about to come to an end, I have seen and experienced a great many things. Things that I will always hold near and dear to my heart. I have seen the smiles on the faces of FFA members winning awards. I felt the tremendous pride of our organization at the National Convention in Kansas City, Missouri. And I have seen the look of wonder in the eyes of children as they have passed through our FFA barnyards.
What I felt was right.
And I can still remember the first day I walked into Mr. Reimer's VOAG 1 class. And little did I know that there was a whole new world opening up to me. And that it was truly going to be the start of something big. For you see, the main reason that I enrolled in vocational agriculture was because I enjoyed working with animals. But as my green hand year progressed, I became aware of the many opportunities available to us in our organization. And I realized that with all these wonderful opportunities, why not take advantage of them? So I set myself some goals, and about a year ago today, on a stage somewhat similar to this in the city of Houston, Texas, I was given the golden opportunity to be a state officer for the Texas Association of Future Farmers of America, and what a wonderful year it has been. You know, there are so many opportunities available to us today. And I can't help but wonder why it is that we don't choose to take advantage of them. Perhaps it's because we are afraid to fail. But you see, we have all failed many times. We fell down the first time we tried to walk. We thought we would drown the first time we tried to swim. And we all fell off and skinned our knees the first time we tried to ride a bicycle. But we all got back up and tried again. Whatever the challenge may be, meet it head on. And meet the challenge with a positive frame of mind. There once was a young medical student who was seriously crippled and was forced to walk on crutches. And of course, his walk was painful and slow. And though he suffered greatly, he was friendly, optimistic, intelligent, and quite cheerful. And during his years at medical school, he acquired many scholastic honors. But his friends never questioned him as to the cause of his deformity, because they did not want to bring up a subject which might be painful to him. But one day, a close friend asked the tainted question. Infantile paralysis was the quick reply. The friend said, "Well, then tell me, with such a misfortune, how can you face the world so confidently and without bitterness?" A warm smile appeared upon the young man's face, and he said, "You see, the paralysis never touched my heart." Future farmers, never let the desires and the dreams in your heart be paralyzed because of a fear of failing. So I urge each of you to go forward, to take some chances, and to use this day to your fullest potential. Because God has given me this day to use as I will. I can waste it or use it for good. What I do this day is very important, because I'm exchanging it for a day of my life. And when tomorrow comes, this day will be gone forever, leaving something in its place that I have traded it for. I want it to be gain, not loss, good, not evil, success, not failure, in order that it shall be worth the price that I paid for it. Future farmers, you are the backbone of this organization, and you are what makes this organization so great. The FFA was founded on a dream, and now it's your turn to keep that dream moving. We've always reached for a higher aim, higher goal, and reached for a new spirit. But you see, all you have to do is have a dream to do better than ever before. All you need to have is faith, and this will truly be the start of something big. And now, I should come to what is perhaps the most difficult part of a state officer's job. I have to say goodbye. Goodbye to an organization that has meant so much to me. It's kind of hard to just close a chapter of my life, knowing that I'll probably never again wear this blue and gold jacket. It's kind of hard to imagine. Words really can't express how I feel for this organization and for all of you. It really has been a wonderful year. The FFA has given so much to me, and I know that I can't even begin to repay this organization for what it has done. It's given me new experiences, new challenges, but most of all, it's given me new friendships that I will cherish for the rest of my life. The only payments I have is my continuing support for this great organization, and many thank yous. I'd like to again thank my advisors, Mr. Wesley Odell and Mr. Mike Reimer. A guy couldn't have two better ag teachers. Next, I'd like to thank my parents and my little brother. Mom, Dad, and Brian. Many times you did without so that I may have. I want to thank you for always being there for me. I love you. A big thanks to Mr. Benny Clark and to Mr. Jay Udy for their unselfish dedication in guiding this great organization. And a big thanks to all of you, the Texas Association of Future Farmers of America. You have made this year worthwhile for me, and I must say you've been a real inspiration. But perhaps the biggest thank you of all goes to my 9 brothers and sisters on my left. Aaron, Greg, David, Misty, Jay and Brad, Nancy, Jerry and John. You've made this year for me very enjoyable, and I'm glad that I can call you my friends. I want you to know that this year that we've had together will never be forgotten. And I love you. Thank you and God bless you.
Lord, it's me again. They're waiting, and I don't know what to say. I tried to put the words down on paper, but the words wouldn't come. Lord, will you help me? Help me tell them what they've done for me, what they've meant to me.
Be true, because there's so many memories still fresh in my mind. I remember the first speech I ever gave. I was so scared. My knees felt like jello, and I kept hoping I wouldn't throw up when I got in front of the microphone. And I remember the summer I went to an FFA camp in Glen Rose, Texas. When we went swimming, I jumped off the diving board and broke my foot. And you know, It seems like only yesterday I was standing on a stage in Houston, Texas, with 9 other people, hoping to fulfill a dream. Those are such sweet memories. Not because of the things I've done, but because of the things you've done. You are the people who have laughed with me and worked with me, and you gave me a shoulder to cry on when I needed it. At one time, I only had 2 brothers, but now I've got 8 more. And I never knew what it was like to have a sister, but I know now. Thank you, Aaron and Greg, David and Misty, Jay and Brad, Scott, John and Jerry. Thank you all for being a part of my life. I love you. There's so many others. There's Benny Clark and Jade, who took me under their wings and helped me through this year. And my advisor, Raby Smalley, who was like a father to me. And my own mom and dad, who always gave me a lift when I needed it. All of you future farmers are my friends and my family. Do you remember when you were a little kid and your mom or your dad would come in at night and they would tell you bedtime stories? Well, when I was a little bitty girl, I'm talking knee-high to a cricket, my grandmother used to come in and she told me this story once and it stayed with me for years. It seems that when God was creating the earth, he was trying to figure out what he would do with all the things that made mankind special. God was trying to figure out where he would put all of man's talents and abilities. So God decided he'd go talk to some angels to see if they had any good ideas. One angel suggested that God put all the things that made mankind special in a little gold box. By doing so, God could give man the box, man could open it up, and everyone would have their fair share of talents and abilities. But God knew that man could be selfish, and there would be one man who hid that box away for himself and never opened it. So another angel suggested that God put all the things that made mankind special, like fruit on the trees. By doing so, all man would have to do is pick the fruit of God's gift. But God knew that man would become lazy and complacent, and there would always be some men who never realized the true potential of their talents and abilities. After some discussion, God decided to put all the things that made mankind special in a place where they'd be right there for us. God put our talents and abilities within us. All we have to do is reach down deep and set those talents and abilities free. I have seen so much talent and so much ability in the young people of this organization. Each one of you has some special, some unique gift. I want you to think about something for a moment. Have you ever known anyone who was a really good athlete and they quit working out? It doesn't take long for that athlete to get out of shape, and then he's not a good athlete anymore. If a singer doesn't keep singing, her voice loses that conditioning and she's not a good singer anymore. One of my very favorite books says, "For to everyone who has, will more be given, and he will have abundance. But to him who has not, even what he has will be taken away." You live in the only country in the world where you have the freedom to decide to use your talents in any way you see fit. And instead of hiding those talents, instead of letting them waste away, future farmers use those very special God-given gifts to get involved in the world around you, because this world needs you. Now, I know just as sure as I'm standing here, there is someone out there saying, "Nancy, I've got problems of my own. I don't have the time to get involved with everybody else." Well, you listen to me, future farmers.
There comes a time when you think, I could have done that, or I should have done this. And by that time, it's too late. By simply trying to do your best, you could be the single factor that makes a difference in somebody else's life. During the spring, I was asked to help judge the Nacogdoches FFA public speaking contest. There was a young man in that contest who knew what he wanted to give a speech about, but he couldn't find any material. The day before the contest, he stayed up all night writing a speech over something related to his original topic. The next day, that young man did a fine job presenting his speech at that contest. When we announced the results, everyone gathered in the room. Eighth place was announced.
Seems to me.
And I heard a little moan of disappointment in the back of the room. Seventh place was announced. And I heard the same thing. When sixth place was announced, the young man's name was called out. And his reaction went unnoticed by almost everyone in that room. But that young man sat there and went, all right! All right. The most remarkable thing I had ever seen. The guy didn't win. He didn't even come close. But he used his talent. He got involved. He did his best. And that young man doesn't know it, but he made a difference in my life. You know, I don't think there'll ever be such a thing as life after FFA, because this organization is in your hands now. If each and every one of you will have the courage to stand up for the things in which you believe, if you'll use your talents and do your very best, carry a little love with you wherever you go, you'll make a difference in someone's life.
I've got problems.
Thank you for making a difference in mine, future farmers. God bless you.
Someday when we learn that no one's strong enough to make it on their own, I just hope there's someone there.
Future farmers, as I stand before you to deliver my retiring address, I don't think that I can describe to you the emotions that are going through me right now. For you see, this retiring address is the realization of a dream for me that I have had since attending my first state FFA convention when I was a green hand. But it is also the realization that tomorrow, when your new state FFA president taps his gavel, that dream so sweetly achieved will be so bitterly ended. It is
a realization that tomorrow I must say goodbye. Goodbye to an organization that through the past 5 years has been such a special and important part of my life. One that has given me so much more than I ever gave to it. An organization that presented me with endless opportunities, but most importantly, gave me the chance to be a better man. Goodbye to the future farmers of America. Goodbye to the blue and gold. Goodbye to 9 young men and women who throughout the past 12 months have been a source of inspiration, of courage, and of love. But most importantly, who have without fail shown undying loyalty and friendship. Aaron, so future farmers, as I say goodbye, let me tell you that you made the difference. And as I say goodbye, let me challenge you to continue to make the difference for the Texas Association of Future Farmers of America. And you say, Jerry, how can I make the difference? I am one of 55,000 members of the Texas FFA. I can't make the difference. Well, maybe you're right. Maybe you can't change the governor's opinion of the future farmers of America. Maybe you can't change the legislature's position on vocational agriculture. And maybe you can't change the State Board of Education's opinion of vocational education. But maybe, just maybe, you can. One day a young man was walking along the beach at low tide. And as he walked along, he saw starfish that were stranded on the sand. And as he would come to a starfish, he would reach down and pick it up and throw it back into the ocean. And as he walked along saving the starfish, an old man who had lived on the beach all of his life came up to him and said, "Young man, what are you doing? There are miles and miles of this beach and thousands upon thousands of starfish. There is no way that you can make a difference." The young man kind of stopped and he thought for a moment. He looked down and picked up another starfish. And he looked at it in his hand for a second, and he smiled, and he threw it back into the ocean. He turned to the old man and he said, "Sir, to him, I made all the difference in the world. Future farmers, you can make all the difference in the world. Folks, listen to me when I tell you, it's not the size of the dog in the fight. It's the size of the fight in the dog. Future farmers, each of you has that fight inside of you. And if you will only believe in yourself, you can find that fight and you can make the difference. There once was a young man who set a goal for himself to play high school football. This is in itself isn't such an unusual goal, but let me tell you a little bit about the young man. He was born with one leg shorter than the other one. He couldn't see very well, and he couldn't run very fast, and he was a little guy. He tried out for the football team. His coaches told him he couldn't make it, but he kept trying out. Finally, he made it, played high school football.
When his high school career was over, he wanted to play college football. Again, the coaches told him, son, you've got one leg shorter than the other one. You can't see very well, and you can't run very fast. And you're too small. You can't play college football. You'll just get hurt. But the young man didn't listen. He tried out and made the team at SMU. And when his college career was over, as you may guess, the young man wanted to play professional football. Again, the coaches told him, son, there's no way a man with your physical handicaps can play the game of football. It's too tough for you. But the young man didn't listen. He was drafted, tried out, made the team, went on to become one of the best wide receivers that the NFL has ever known. He's a member of the Hall of Fame. And last year, he led his New England Patriots to a berth in the Super Bowl. Because folks, Raymond Berry believed in himself, and he knew that he could make the difference. Future farmers, the greatest love of all is inside of you. And if you will just look for that fight, it's easy to achieve. Yes, future farmers, the greatest love of all is inside of you. Learn to love yourself. Learn to believe in yourself. And future farmers, if you never remember Jerry Cole was a state officer, and if you never remember anything that he did, remember this. Remember that he tried to get you to see the beauty you got inside of you. Remember that he wanted you to see the pride that you can have. Because he knows it's going to make it easier for you. He wants you to laugh. And remember how good you can be. Future farmers, never walk in one shadow. Because if you fail, or if you succeed, it won't make any difference if you live as you believe. And if you do that, no matter what anybody takes away from you, they cannot take away your dignity. Find that greatest love of all. Future farmers, before I close, I want to leave you with one thing. And if you don't remember anything about me, please remember this. Always, always believe in you. I do.
You know, friends, it's really hard for me to believe that after wearing this blue and gold jacket for over 6 years, that I'm actually wearing it for the very, very last time. 6 years ago, I would have never dreamed of standing right here in front of you, 5,000 Texas future farmers. Why, 6 years ago, why, standing in front of you is the person who once had a dream to someday become a state officer. But he also is the same person who thought he had the lack of material or was capable of fulfilling the image of the Texas officers in the past. But thanks to two men who saw differently in myself, I'm standing up here in front of you today thanks to those two men. And luckily enough, they're here with us this morning. These two men inspired me to go for my dreams and taught me that I could do anything I put my mind to. The first man I'd like to tell you about is a very, very fine product of the Texas FFA. He was once a state officer. He grabbed me in my arm in 1982 and he put inside me the willingness to succeed, the power to realize my dreams. And he told me that my dreams could become reality with a little hard work and self-confidence. He started that spark that'll never go out. And well, David Booth, I guess it worked. I'm up here. I appreciate that. Many, many thanks. The second man I'd like to tell you about is somebody who's no stranger to the FFA. He was very active in his FFA in high school. He taught vocational agriculture for 20 years. And for the past 9 years, he has been very close to the Texas FFA. This man would keep me on my toes and keep me going when I felt like giving up, when I felt like quitting. So to him, I want to say, thanks, Dad. I just want to make you proud of me. I have to tell you a story that I've told my state officers and told just about every banquet I went to. And I was hesitating about telling it to y'all, but I think it's only appropriate to set an example. As a freshman in high school, me and my best friend were asked to present the flags at the State Young Farmer Convention 6 years ago in Corpus Christi. Well, we were in official dress. We got there to Corpus and we presented the flags and everything, and the state president came up to us from the Young Farmers and told us, John, Justin, why don't y'all go around and be seen? Let the people know that the FFA is here. So we did. But to fill you in a little bit, I need to tell you that my best friend and I worked for the same equipment dealer 6 years ago. This equipment dealer gave us keys and locks to every piece of equipment he had, farm equipment, tractors, combines, what have you. Well, back to the convention, my best friend and I were walking around and he looked up and said, John, look. And there in front of us was the prettiest, brightest, green John Deere tractor you ever seen in your whole life. We weren't used to cab tractors. So we thought we'd take a look at a brand new cab tractor. We got inside and Justin said, do you have your key with you? And I said, yeah. And he said, well, see if it sticks in the ignition. So I took the key and stuck it in the ignition and turned it back. Sure enough, the radio came on. It was on for about 15 seconds and we got tired of that. So I grabbed my key ring with my middle finger to pull the key out and get down out of the tractor. Well, if you're thinking what I'm thinking, you guessed it. That tractor cranked up in the middle of that convention in the Coliseum, and smoke bellowed out everywhere. And before I could get the key out kill the tractor, get out of the tractor. There are security guards, firemen, policemen, young farmers, and one daddy, which made him all worse than all four of those. Well, that's what I've been trying to do this year as I travel around this great state. I tried to do the same thing. No, not start tractors at conventions, but publicize the FFA. Yes, at that convention, they knew the FFA was there. I have driven almost 14,000 miles this year, meeting new friends and devoting full time to this organization. With knowledge, experience, and opportunities that have come my way, in my opinion, as I had to leave from college, was far more rewarding than a whole year of college. So let's get out there and be the best, not second best. Let's show the people, the public, that FFA is the greatest youth organization in the world. First of all, I want to thank our 11th team member. Our 11th team member is God. He has been with us everywhere. And I want to thank him for you, because without you, there would be no need for me. I want to thank him for the greatest mom and dad in the whole wide world. And I want to say something to them that I don't think I've ever said before. Mom and Dad, I love you. Most of all, I just want to thank him for my 9 brothers and sisters. Aaron, Greg, David, Misty, and Jay, Brad, Scott, Nancy, and last but not least, Cole. They're my 9 brothers and sisters. They're my best friends. They're my family away from family. I'd like to thank y'all for the fantastic memories, the talks, and the inspirations. The inspirations that you have given me, and also the 55,000 members of the Texas Association. Most of all, the honor of serving with you, the 9 darn best state officers ever. It's comforting to know that the future is in hands like yours. I love you. Thank you.